Hello, everybody. I'm Randy.
Hey, guys. I'm CJ. And it's Friday.
Yes.
Thank you, Father God, for Fridays. I always loved Friday. Everybody loves Friday. And there's a good reason. Because this is preparation hours for the Sabbath. Tonight, when the sun goes down, we will be entering into the Sabbath day of rest. So get all your shopping done today. Get all your running around done this day. And take the day off totally tomorrow. Don't do any of your traditional scurrying about stuff. Just, have some fun. Relax and teach your children about their Father in heaven. Raise the name of the Lord. Give over your praise and all of that. Give it up for God. Tell me this. What God would put into the plan a day of rest? Yahweh Akbar, the Lord our God, the Lord Almighty, the Father of Yeshua of Nazareth. Who's that? Who's that character? That Yeshua of Nazareth is the one and only Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary. You mean that one foretold by Gabriel? Yep, that one. Christ Jesus, anointed, beloved.
Amen.
Yeah, amen and aho.
Well, as you were saying, it is TGIF.
It is TGIF. And so for those that may be listening from a land far, far away, and you may be going, what is TGIF? That means, thank God, it's Friday.
Right.
Woohoo!
Well, we're looking forward to this weekend. I know that, just for us personally, and all the things that we're going to be doing, and I just pray that all those that are listening have a blessed weekend, the same as we are anticipating, and that the things of the world put behind you and come forth to the Father's threshold and hang out with Him during this Shabbat weekend.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's right.
Well, CJ, one of the things that I came across a really really cool email, and I don't remember which particular one that I got, but the article that I got was about Noah's legacy.
Noah's legacy. Well, he did leave a legacy because all of us are here.
Well, you know, and it's taught that way, that the legacy was that all of us came as a result of that, but this took it a different path.
All right. What did they tell? Well, what did they add to the story?
Let me ask you a question.
Uh-oh. I love that. You know I've got answers. Well, it's rare that I don't. But sometimes I don't.
Well, in the New Testament, it teaches that we're not saved by just faith alone.
You want to give a Bible scripture?
Okay.
Because I can think of a passage that says you are saved by faith alone. So I don't want to really jump into the middle of that.
Well, faith without works is dead.
Well, that is true. We are saved by faith alone. But the point is, if you truly have faith, if you've really been born again, you have a desire. It's internal.
Absolutely.
It comes out of you, which the testimony is, without works, that means that there's a missing element in there. Either your faith isn't purely true, yes, full, or you weren't born again.
There you go.
Either way, and since Yeshua, Jesus, says you must be born of both water and fire, spirit, however it is.
But did I not answer your question by saying that faith without works is dead, and then you embellished on it even further to understand that there is, if you really are in that full faith realm, then the things that you do, and you call those deeds, the things that you do is what finishes the package.
Yeah, I have no problem giving you some credit. I do think it was a work of God,
No,
he works through human hands. And And so, yeah,
Okay.
yeah,
So
it all goes together.
that the point that I was trying to make about Noah's legacy. Well, this article that I was reading.
So then when you open, did you mean email
Yeah, one of my
or
emails.
oh, okay. All right. So, all right. Thank you.
And so what they were talking about was, besides the fact that we're still here,
Right.
it was his deeds that are still coming forward,
The fruit of his
even though he's
deeds.
gone.
The fruit of
So it's
his
his
deeds.
deeds.
Well, yes, and I know you're about to say something else, so I should refrain from expressing any
No, go
further. But
ahead.
no, I mean, I really don't want to sidetrack. I don't want you to forget where you're at. So,
I'm fine.
well, you want to make your statement again then? Because I backed out like a kid who
Okay.
grabbed the ball who wasn't supposed to
Well,
get in the game
all
yet.
right. Well, the deal is that there's two things, even though his legacy was known for Noah's legacy was known for the fact that we're all physically here. Well, the spirit of Noah is still alive and well. And then his deeds, the things that he did, is still alive and well, even though his flesh is not with us anymore. Okay? So
And so
there.
when you say that, I can just feel people's internal mental clock ticking here, anticipating and adding up all these things. When you say the spirit of Noah, and I can hear people say, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. There's just like one, there's the Holy Spirit. It's the only one that really matters. But I know what you're talking about. The lifeblood energy that they expelled in their own lifetime, they left behind a
The
legacy.
work that he did of pulling the ark
Well,
together.
the work he did of being obedient to God. God found Noah to be a righteous man. Therefore, while Yahweh was Yud-Heh Yahweh, while he was prepared to extinguish all form of life, his entire creation, for he had grown fed up to past here with it and was out operating in pure patience. And then as he's, like you say, he's primed, he's ready to destroy. And one man catches his, catches the eye of Yahweh, and in him he found a righteous man. It's not like it took God by surprise because he's seen the whole game film, but let's say the first time he finds in Noah lived up to what God had programmed within him, because I think all of us are programmed towards beauty and good stuff. Do we walk in that in that seed that is within? Do we roll the stone away from our heart and let it get light, sun, S-O-N, sunlight, and living water? Does it fall upon it and grow, prosper, or does it is it does it wither in the dark space, dry? And so that's really then what we all do who believe. That's our call, and that brings forth the works. The works aren't even so much like what we're doing here to have a radio station. Nowhere in there does it say have a radio station and talk about me all day. It tells us to go forth and do things, feed the hungry, go forth and clothe the naked, go forth and do these things. So even in our own ministry, we have to understand in ourself that this is only part of the package. We come out, why do we talk about it? Well, we hope to inspire others to walk in faith, to live out to the glory of God, to do the things, because we are in that time. And with every breath we share those prophetic words that God has said, and allow them to be measured up against the current events of the day, what's happening, so that our greatest prayer is that many be saved by belief in the Lord Yeshua, and literally come to fully trust the Lord God Almighty, Yahweh, our Father in heaven, come to fully trust the the strong right arm, which is Yeshua, the Son God chose to be the one to come, that the world through him the world might be saved.
Amen. Yeah. So all of these things that you're talking about, right? I want to go back to Noah.
You have such an amazing way of doing that. And I love that about you.
And his children and his wife.
Yes. Okay.
And this is what was the cool thing about this.
His three sons and his three sons' daughters, as right. well as Noah's own.
Right.
I just feel like I should put the wives on the ship.
Okay, first off, the wife, mm-hmm. his wife, Noah's wife.
Right. Does she have a name, by the way?
Yeah, Kael or something like that.
Okay, because I don't remember that.
It was in this article that I read. But she was noticed, her deeds mm-hmm. were that she was a servant to all of her children
awesome.
And all of the family. She served them mm-hmm. in Noah. Mm-hmm. So she was known as a not a housemaker, mm-hmm. but somebody that took care of and nurtured the family and the children and all of that. That was what she was noted for.
You know, the interesting thing about that is that's the credit that our children give to me. They've said before, I was the one that kept our family together. But from my heart, I give that to you because I know the tenderness with which you nurtured their day-to-day existence through the work
that's
of your
hands. That's the physical side of it.
And
they're talking about the spiritual side of it for you.
Yeah. So, and God builds packages.
Yeah.
It's a package deal.
Yeah.
We're given children. We have to nurture them yeah. fleshly yeah. and spiritually is the call.
So, one of Noah's sons was a musician.
I did not know that. Totally. Took my breath away. I got coffee stuck in my throat.
Yeah.
One of his sons was a musician.
Yeah. Then one of his sons was like a sheep herder and a cattle herder and you know, knew how to handle the mm-hmm. the animals.
Right.
And then there was one son that knew how to do metal work.
Okay.
That knew how to make swords. Mm. That knew how to be able to take those things and make different things with it.
Let me just guess here. One was a musician.
Right.
One was a herdsman, of the animal keeper, the animal taker, carer, of her.
Right.
How do you say that?
Well, you're headed in the right direction.
One was a metalworks person, which we all admire these metalwork things, but that's kind of, it gets us into that idolatry.
So who do you think he was?
Even with weapons. I'm kind of thinking he's the one that kind of got things messed up that ultimately slept with his mom.
Ham.
That I just couldn't
correct.
Tell you which his name was. But
okay.
I just think of him as the
All right.
as the black sheep of
so
the family.
So does that not fit in
yeah.
with where we're at and the things that are going on in Israel right now?
Well, you're going to have to do the math for me on that because you're the historian in the family.
Well, okay. The Palestinians are considered the Arabs.
The Palestinians are considered Arabs, okay?
Okay. And they live by the sword and die by the sword. Their philosophies that taught by their Muslim faith.
Oh, it's not like Yeshua said to us, if you live by the sword, you will die by the sword. So it's you choose your footing, choose your way. And so you're saying within the Arab mindset is... the fighter.
Right.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to just put down the word sword. Okay.
All right. And so then you have the other two types, which was the musician and then the one that is able to do the raising of the cattle. And
I want to choose Seth. And no, Seth's not one of them. Is he? No, he's not. Seth was the son of Adam.
Right.
Shem. I don't know that I perfectly have to say Shem, Japheth.
That's right.
And Ham.
That's correct.
I'm going to say Shem was the musician.
No.
No. Okay, I should have just shut up.
Okay. But it's okay. What's important here is that we got to understand that okay, Ham went off and went and created this whole empire himself, along with the Ishmael and all of that. Okay, and we know that they were warriors. Yes.
Okay.
And Esau.
Okay, so Ham, I'm making notes. Plus Esau.
And Ishmael.
Plus Ishmael. Some of you guys, I know y'all recognize those names. Can you put them with the story they go with? All right. And I'm not asking you to. I'm just asking our friends listening. Can they?
Okay.
Okay, so Ham plus Esau equal. What do they become? The warriors? Or what did you call them? What did you say of them?
The Arabs.
The Arabs. Okay.
And now, we, because of later, the Roman Empire, which is...
Now, that's a twist that most people wouldn't know.
Right.
Okay, so you want to... It is part of your program to build a link to that.
No, and that's just so massive.
Okay.
I'm sure.
So you might have to research
stay with
that yourself.
Deeds. I
want
to. I'm trying
deeds.
To stay with deeds so that we can understand where you know the accomplishments of those areas and mm-hmm. where those types of deeds that are occurring in the Arab world against the other groups.
Right.
Okay. Now, at the same time, we're sitting here looking at Japheth and Shem,
mm-hmm.
and how Shem, like you were talking about, the descendants of Shem
mm-hmm.
from Abraham and so on and so forth,
right.
how they ended up in Jacob, how they all ended up in this in favor of the Lord.
Okay.
Okay, and that their existence isn't based on... hate and killing. Their existence is based on peace and tranquility and getting along with each other, even though they've had some major issues in the past, like we've all done.
Yeah,
but the philosophies that is written in the Holy Bible mm-hmm. is different than those that are of the other types of so I'm trying to stay with deeds on
I'm
this
listening.
Before I get too far
don't
away
go, don't you're not You're,
all right.
the, so, you're the speaker.
All right. So first what I want to do is read.
Control thyself. Okay. Walk where you want to go.
The first thing I want to do is read this.
Hey, you're,
James 2.
I'm seeing. Look at that. Look at your control panel just a moment, please. Okay. It just seemed like it might be frozen in space.
No. James 2:14-26. I want to read this.
All right.
And I'm
James
reading from the King James Version.
14-26.
What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith, but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus also faith by itself, it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. You believe that there is one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac, his son, on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works? And by works faith was made perfect. And the scripture was fulfilled which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. You see then that a man is justified by works, and not by faith alone. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. So, I kindle this to Noah and his obedience and what he did, the righteousness of what you're talking about, and then he coming forward and doing the things that he was supposed to do, have done, that God told him to do, and then the fruits of what he came forward from and how things moved forward the way that the fruits went. Some of the fruits went one south and one went north. And it was totally in God's control of how these things happened, the way that they were supposed to happen. So, I thought that was really cool about how we look at each other and we do the things that we do, and sometimes we think that it's not righteous, because like in Sarah's case, for Abraham to take Isaac up and was going to sacrifice him, mm-hmm. She was like, you know that she was like, what is he doing?
Yeah, I mean, of course.
Okay.
And I don't know if it's perfectly portrayed through the Bible version of the movie.
Yeah, I'm speaking off of what the Bible says, and I'm just kind of like...
I'm just trying to get a mental image in my mind of... I don't know if it's perfectly exemplified in the movie, the Bible, which many people have seen, which make it a talking point. If it's perfectly put up there the way that it's demonstrated, but what's the likelihood? To me, it seems very unlikely that Abraham came and spoke to Sarah and said, oh, by the way, I'm taking Isaac up the mountain. I'm going to sacrifice him. What's the likelihood that even Isaac understood? Because don't you anticipate...
Well, no, that isn't biblically. It says, Father, we do not have a sacrifice.
Yes, and God, and he and Abraham responded, God will provide.
Yes.
So Isaac did not know.
He didn't.
That this is my point. It's not like that he built this case. He didn't come in the door. He was surely in his own heart praying all the way up the mountain that God will surely provide. But yet he went forward in faith that if that were the ultimate end, I mean, he's took the steps, but if he had hardened, I think it's that moment. It's like the Bible says, if this day you hear the voice of the Lord, harden not your heart. Well, what if Abraham had gotten so intensely built up in Amos, or whatever that statement is, what if he had gotten so fired up that when he got up there, he could no longer hear the voice of the Lord? And then when the Lord spoke and said, Abraham, you know, and caused his hand to be to stay, to stop, and then... He shows him in the burning bush, he shows him caught in the bush, a tangled up, an offering. Well, if he had hardened his mind to just get this job done, and he pursued on with almost a venomous heart, potent Arach, Hamatz, Amos, and whatever all those words are, he may have been so swift in his action that he in that moment hardened his heart towards the voice of the Lord. But because he really was a man of God, walking with God in perfect faith, he heard the word, he heard the instruction, he took his son, he took the necessary tools, and he went to make the sacrifice. Let everyone know we're going up the mountain to make a sacrifice. Surely, just as Isaac wondered, you know, hey, Pops, aren't we going to take something to sacrifice? Surely Sarah was thinking, well, this is kind of odd. They normally take an animal or whatever. And was that even because of his youthfulness, was that in fact Isaac's first time to accompany his dad up the mountain to sacrifice before Yahweh? Well, you know, some of that information may be recorded somewhere. I don't recall it being in the Bible that it identified if it was his first or one of many times. But it was that at least Isaac had seen the process enough times, he knew what should be, he knew the steps of what should be happening. Hey, aren't we leaving out something here? Aren't we, don't we need to take it something to sacrifice? And Abraham, you know, in his fatherly way, just says, Yahweh will provide. God will, I'm sure he didn't probably say it that way. Hashem will provide, maybe he said. And so they, and Isaac's brought up learning to honor your father. My father says that God will provide. God will provide. I worry not, you know. Look what all the things my dad has accomplished in his lifetime on pure faith and listening to God. And so, yeah, not a thing of it seems out of order for me. It just brings up this rich tapestry, this painting. I can almost just see it being painted before, you know, before our eyes. And just, you know, giving, that's who does not want to have faith like that? We all want faith like that. And not one of us, God, want to be instructed to do such a thing.
Well, please understand.
And it would never happen again, for God himself provided the sacrifice please. Once and for all.
Yeah, absolutely.
Of Nazareth.
Absolutely. That's why that happened the way that it did.
Absolutely.
But now while we are talking about what we have done and what our legacy
would be.
Wouldn't necessarily be that God's going to come up upon you and expect you to sacrifice.
No, he wouldn't, because he fulfilled that
exactly.
himself.
So what it amounts to is that you need to look at yourself, uh-huh. where your walk in the Lord in the kingdom is,
and
then measure that. What are the things that you're doing to expand the kingdom? What are you doing that God has told you straight up, this is what I want you to do?
Has God instructed you with something aside from what Scripture straightforward instructs us to do?
Right. So, and then how far along have you done that? How serious have you taken those things that he's given you to do? And you know, is it a question in your mind whether if he really meant it or not? Is it a question in your mind on if he even said that was something else that that created that condition in your mind? So what I'm, the whole point of why I'm bringing this information together the way that I did is that God was trying to take yours and mine discussions that we've had last night at 4 a.m. in the morning.
We talk a lot, y'all. We don't just talk on the radio.
I know.
Blah, 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 all day long.
You see, there is this thing that we miss, and it is God trying to get us to understand that the perceptions of what we see and hear and do are two sides of a coin. Yeah. And where is it, does our spirit take that, I'm going to say, legacy of that moment? Where does our spirit decide to embellish the moment? And what do we do internally to cultivate it? And is it going to go south or is it going to go north? When we witness something, when we hear something, when we say something, What is it that God is trying to get us to come forward with? And sometimes we get mixed up in it. And one of the difficult things that we're having, and that is the time that we're in, because if you remember, many years ago, I'm talking about in the 50s and 60s, everybody thought it was plain and dry about what the expectations of the United States were, what the expectations are of Russia. I mean, it was like a free world against communism. It was like a line drawn. Well, these lines are being diminished to the point that you don't know who's on whose side and what's happening. And that's happening on the level of individuals. And this is designed for confusion purposes. That Hasatan don't want us to know who is on our side and who is against us. He wants us to know, and that's why it's so important for our Heavenly Father impending upon us to stay true to His, to faith to Him, and that our works correlate to Him, then there is no division.
Yeah, we have to know, we have to be sure that our works correlate to what the Master has called us to do.
Yes.
So that would go with that point when He says, go away from me, I never knew you. And people, it's, you know, given that people would be saying, but didn't I do, in the Bible it says, but didn't I do this for you and didn't I do that? And the question becomes, but is that what He asked you to do? You could, let's say you get hired for a job and you go, and your job was, let's just say, to be the greeter at the store and stand at the door and smile at everyone who came in, make eye contact with them, offer them assistance of like a basket or whatever, you know, can you tell me where the honey is, and you say aisle 17 or however that goes. But you just welcome them, you're the greeter at the store, you welcome them, thank you for shopping at our store today. And so that, let's just say that's what God has called us to do, to be the greeter and to give people a good taste in their mouth of what believing and walking with the Lord is.
Amen.
But we build ministries, we build church buildings, we build whatever it is we do. We run around. Let's just even say music. I'm just going to try to think of everything that we do. And other people that we know. So let's say do music, do even movies, do plays, do websites, do radio, do all kinds of stuff. Works, works, works. But is it in step with what the Lord Himself, our Master, literally told us to do? So when we finally meet the Lord face to face and eye to eye, will He say, well done, my faithful servant? Or will He say, what up with all of that? What were you doing? Did I ask you to do that?
Right. Good question.
So what I'm going to look up real quick, you guys, is my question is, and you know, that's a cool picture. My question is, how do I refine this? What does the Lord require of you? Okay, so what does the Lord require of you? What is His instructions? And this does take me to Micah. I thought it might take me there, but that's not really the question. I meant the Lord Jesus. But this is, okay, let's go with this. Let's go with Micah 6:8. And it takes us, what does the Lord require of you? Which is really a great place to start. According to the NIV version and the King James, here's the question. My question was, what does the Lord require of you? And here's the response, Micah chapter 6, verse 8. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So then we ask ourselves in our own, it's like, not this isn't the quiz for, I don't look at my husband in the eye and say, so Randy, do you act justly? Do you love mercy? And do you walk humbly with your God? I mean, that's first off, I hope you see that's not humble. Absolute, right? That's the kind of thing that builds battles between people. When God asks us this question, He's anticipating, as it's recorded, that the reader is being asked these questions. So we internalize, we ask ourselves, what does the Lord require of me? And we're like, oh good, it's going to tell me. Well, here's what the Lord requires of me, to act justly. So all of a sudden, as those words penetrate the cerebral chamber of our mind, as it opens the door and comes into our mind and our heart, we quickly, I mean, this is what you would, what God would anticipate. This is what I would anticipate as a writer or a teacher or something, that if these words were presented, I would instantly anticipate that the listener would begin to search themselves and Amen. Say, do I act justly? And if that, and if the person instantly goes to, you can also tell a level of maturity. If they go, well, I do this and I do that and I do this and I do that, all these things, and giving themselves lots of credit, maybe some of the credit they deserve, but what about the parts? Do they actually, or are they the person that goes, well, I didn't act justly at this moment, and I didn't act justly. Is this person, do they have an awareness of a full picture? Can they see themselves both coming in the mirror and going away from the mirror? Do you see both your face that you would want to think you're presenting, and even that part that as you walk away, what did the world really see of you? So to act justly and to love mercy, when you see things going on worldwide and around you, does your heart tremble inside with, what if that was me and my child? What if that was my loved one? Do we really love mercy? What if the crowd is all saying, stoner, or lynch him, or whatever, like the Hitler kind of mentality. If you see the world doing a thing, do you have the strength, the fortitude to be a voice that's different if the popular thing to do is to rally around, I don't know, let's say President Obama or some other one? Are you inclined toward being received well by the crowd? And that could even be sitting in a theater in the audience, seeing what's happening on stage and knowing it unfairly, there's something unrighteous about it or unjust about it. And then also, even in all of these things, to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God, do we then become, we become so victorious that we stand up and we're like, and you do this, and you're doing that. And you know, is that humble? Hello? You know, would you, if somebody was there with their finger in your face, pointing you out and saying, you know, not kindness towards you, doesn't mean I'm not talking about blowing smoke rings around you to falsely build you up. I'm talking about even delivering a hard message with the kind of kindness or compassion that might actually lead that person to change. Now, if that person is, you know, your back's against the wall and it's in a brutal moment, you know, there's no choice but to be direct. You must stop that now. You know, that is, you know, so abhorrent to, just like, I don't know. I got a lot of words. But yeah. This isn't even the answer.
Isn't that great, though? I started off with this discussion about Noah and his deeds and his legacy.
Absolutely.
And how it unfolds down to us on what we do on a daily basis. And how,
absolutely,
how we have... You have to understand that the things that we do, what kind of an impact that it's going to have on the world, what kind of an impact it's going to have around your family. Do the things that you do, do you really want to be remembered for those things that you're doing right now?
Are they really
going to be remembered? Think about this.
How do you want to be remembered?
In
God's eyes above all.
Above all.
Yeah.
But see, what has lived longer in Noah's case was all the good things that he did.
Absolutely. History doesn't carry forth any of Noah's dirt.
Right.
All that was washed away in the flood.
It was.
And all that mattered is that God found in him one righteous man. And he is a direct representation of Yeshua of Nazareth, the beloved Son of God, Christ Jesus. In Yeshua, God sent, God gave to the world. He didn't even have to wait for a hope and if. He sent to the world his very own life and Son, knowing precisely the choices of his heart, that, you know, what would be chosen. And so in him, God chose gave one righteous man to the world that, like it says in the Gospel of John, that through him the world might be saved. And for it was not God's will to destroy the world, but to save. And there's so much words. Go to John 3:16 and read through 18. Even some pick this up as early as John 3:15. I've seen some of the translations. But we have to go with, what does God call us to do? What is our ultimate goal? And you know, when we start talking about, when we see Micah and what Micah was requiring, right. Well, we can go back to Deuteronomy.
Yes.
All right, going back to Deuteronomy, it says, and this is the NIV version, and now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of you? But, here's number one, but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him. It's like a father and child relationship. What does your father want you to do? Ultimately, in that fear is a trusting fear that you mm-hmm. that you know that your dad's in charge. Okay,
that you so will be held accountable for your actions.
Yeah, and that he's not telling you to do badness but goodness. Okay, so to fear the Lord your God, to fear your Father in heaven, to walk in obedience to him, to love him, and to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. So there's fourfold ministry right there. Fear the Lord your God, walk in obedience, love him, serve him with all your heart and with all your soul.
And if you do all those things,
yeah,
then the legacy and then the mm-hmm. works
you're
will
gonna
line
leave
up.
Behind. Absolutely, Randy. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
CJ, thank you for wrapping that up. That's as far as I wanted to go. Personally, I want to go into, there is a ton of newsworthy stuff here.
Let's
on this Friday.
Wow.
That
Friday?
Yes.
October 16th.
That there's so much. And I know that people are busy out there going on, but there's some good things going on, and mm-hmm. there's a lot of bad things right. that's been happening.
Well, before you start reading your list and sharing, just to one more time say, this is Friday Preparation Hours, October 16th, 2015, according to, I'm not going to say the Hebrew calendar, because we know what is pinned in isn't exactly right, but to say that according to Hashem, Adonai, Yahweh, El Shaddai, Elohim's clock, in accordance with the moon and all like that, today is the third day of the eighth month of the 5776th year.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, now thank you, and I'll just listen
all right.
to
it. Yesterday, they publicly announced finding the original notebooks of the 47 translators that created the King James Version Bible.
They found the notebook of the notebooks of the original translators. Well, that's got to have some interesting notes
yes.
in it. And I find it very interesting that it just happens to be found at this time. So I really want to know about if they're really truly from who they say
well,
they're from.
Let me tell you.
And is it God himself presenting them?
I got enough information here that you should be able to make
Ooh,
this.
I can't wait to hear.
Okay, first off, it's from the Cambridge College in England, where King James I is the one that commissioned these 47 translators there at the Cambridge College.
Okay, let's hear.
Okay.
You have my attention.
Well, the notes that they have and that they have found, now, they haven't released any information
right.
in regards
right,
to the
right,
translations,
right.
Translators' booklets.
Okay.
Okay. They found them
okay.
in a locked box that had been sitting there for over 400 years.
Yeah, we're talking about
well,
1600s or 1500s.
1604 to 1608 is when they pulled this information together.
Okay, does it tell you the date the King James Bible was actually published?
1611.
All right. So this is all their pre-work as they determine what to include.
What to go in it.
Right.
And there's notes in Hebrew and in Greek.
Wow.
In all of it.
Wow. Huh.
Okay.
Okay.
So they've never found, they just came across it. They just found it, they say.
And they're even in, so, God could have reserved it for a time such as
for
this.
For it to be found, yeah. For people to bring it out and show where this information is coming from and how. Now, how it's disseminated, that's a different story. Who has their hands on it?
Because you're right back to translations and translators and putting your trust. It's like that song God gave me way back when, Computer Dreams. And if you discovered the greatest truth, would you share fully what you had discovered, or would you, and especially if it negated something that was your foundational lines, would you actually have the I'm not gonna call it tenacity or even courage, would you have the ethical, moral strength of fiber, the godliness within you to share fully exactly what you found without trying to add a lot of extra words to explain how, even though that sounds like it doesn't talk about what we say, it really does represent what we do. You know, like, yeah. Will they share full throttle the complete truth?
I pray that they do.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, and I second that.
Okay.
Took my breath away again. Make me choke when now, things are so, I gotta agree.
Now, the whole point of their comment here is that they said, this will allow us to understand where they came and why they wrote what they wrote, what they came up with and what they wrote. Okay. That was the statement that was given from the official people at Cambridge College, that it was a locker with lots of books and stuff. So you know that it wouldn't be anything that they can just read in 30 seconds and give a synopsis. This is something that's going to require some in-depth study of independence to be able to rationalize this publication. Well, I found that very interesting with all the stuff that's going on in Jerusalem and Israel and the United States, and they found the King James Version and how they're going to bring it forward and how it correlates to the Vatican.
Yeah, how I so trust God in this. That I just want to believe it for the purity of what it is, and knowing that God has the capacity and the power to, no matter what man might try to do for evil, God is always behind the scenes taking and making good of everything for those who truly love Him. So He says He will bring to, He's removing the shades. People talk about the 50 shades of gray, and God said to me, He's pulling back the shades. So what people are trying to do, stepping around and through their own love relation, their own heart commitment relationships, trying to make themselves and others feel like it's okay to do these little things, but yet would never be done in front of their spouse, literal. God Himself is pulling back the shades and will reveal and make it known. And the question is, when He does, do we have the capacity within ourselves to forgive? And so forgiveness is the call of the hour. God says, treat this as a jubilee. Focus on forgiveness. So God forgives, but then that one that you find deeper truths about, is that the person, do you want to be aligned with them? Are they the same person now? I mean, is this something that's old news, that's not them as they are now? Or is this 2 days ago, is this as they are now? Do you want to be aligned with this individual? Yes, you must forgive if you want to be forgiven. But like we're finding out, listen, I'm anticipating we're about to find out stuff about the Vatican,
yes,
the Catholic Church, and all like that. When you discover, when it's And it may be about the Methodists, the Baptist. We don't know who it'll be about.
We will see.
We're going to see.
Yep.
But about the, you know, the translators themselves. And this goes with all those discussions we know they had where Constantine, was this at the same time as Constantine?
No,
that was many years earlier.
This is Martin Luther and the Calvinist activists, and those were, it was separating from the Vatican.
Okay.
And they're coming out doing their thing.
Oh, okay. So that's why the Catholic Church doesn't use the King James Bible.
Right.
They use
their Bible,
their own Catholic version.
Right.
Oh, wow. Wowie zowie. And the Catholic version I'm anticipating then was from the Constantine era.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Exciting times
to live. It is. Okay.
Thank you so much for bringing this to
me. Well, thank you for adding that last piece on there. For people may not understand the difference between Constantine and where it started in the Reformation. The
right.
Reformation was during the 1611. That's why this new publication came forward.
The King James.
Because
why people hold it so dear.
That is correct.
Huh.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you.
Gosh. All right. The next thing is out of Jerusalem, out of Israel.
Uh-huh.
Hamas has declared this day, this holy day, their holy day.
Which started last night,
right,
and it lasts until this evening.
Has declared it a day of rage.
Oh my gosh.
And they went in and they have set afire Joseph's tomb. Now this is
Something about that. Joseph's tomb.
The Jacob's son Joseph. This is the one with the coat of many colors.
This is the one who was an administrator there in Egypt and who interpreted the dreams and let the king know that what he had dreamed meant 7 years of feast and then 7 years of famine. So this is even an indicator
it
from God.
Huge.
Yes, it is, of what we're heading towards. This draconian time.
Exactly. Boy, you're catching on good.
Well,
now
it's
because
not me.
You know,
I do agree. I do enjoy being a part of this. It's God doing the work through both you and me. It's His Holy Spirit.
It's that mirrors of that I keep talking about, that God brings it forward and puts it
absolutely
in the time and perspective of the things that's going on. And it's like we're going into it backwards, but we're going forward.
I know. It's amazing. It's holy.
It really is.
Thank you, Father God. And thank you, Lord Yeshua.
All right.
So, thank you, Holy Spirit.
And something else, and Nehemiah brought this up. Now, I find this very interesting, too. Mm-hmm. Nehemiah Gordon has an article where he got to hold in his hands while he was in Jerusalem, his last trip. He goes a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But while
I didn't
he
want
was,
to go a lot.
He was just there, and he has an interview on his website where he actually held a piece of charred remnant of the Solomon's temple that was, or the 70 AD temple that was burnt to the ground.
Right.
He actually held a piece of that in his hand.
Wow.
And was able to see the inscriptions on it and what it said. My point that I'm trying to make here is that Nehemiah had that charred piece of remnant of the temple in his hand and had that article, and here they set fire to Joseph's tomb.
Right.
And that just happened.
Yeah, so, now Joseph's tomb, my understanding, because I was just reading this in the Bible a couple of evenings ago, Joseph himself was buried in Egypt. His father, Jacob, was returned to the land, to the homeland, and was buried there, but it says that Joseph himself was buried in Egypt.
But his request was that whenever they were set free from Egypt, to take his bones with them and plant them.
That was Jacob.
That was all of them. All of the patriarchs that was...
Okay, well, I didn't read far enough to get to that detail. Because, you know, I've taken the whole thing in, lots of details.
Well, maybe you're right. I'm just, my thinking was is that even though Jacob was the one that actually requested it, I'm thinking that
And
they
did
took
take
all.
Him back. Well, the thing is, that brings up a question, where is this happening? And when I first read the article, I sat there and I processed in my mind, in accordance with what I just read, all right, I'm as I'm reading that article that said that they had burned Joseph's tomb.
Yeah, it's in the Golan Heights area.
Okay, when they said they had burned Joseph's tomb, that my first thought was Joseph versus Jacob. And I'm like going through the lineage, okay, Joseph is the one who was the, you know, served, who was sold away by his brothers, right, put in that trap, you know, and all that. The whole story came to my mind. And he was then the one in charge of the foods and the stuff for the king of Egypt. And then it literally in the scripture, it had said, and when he died, and he was quite a bit younger than his father, which neither one of them lived the amount of years as predecessors, but he lived even less years than Jacob. And it said, and he was buried there in Egypt.
Right.
And so I thought, okay, so this is so great that you bring it up. My question became in my own mind, so then this burning is in Egypt, so there's this strife is going on in both Jerusalem or Israel and Egypt. And then I thought, or is this like one more of many things where, just like the woman there that was the cleaning lady at the tomb of David that I've got to visit with while I was in Israel, and I said, so will you take your picture with me or here at the tomb? And she was like, yeah. And I said, so this is where David was buried? And she says, well, so they say. But she was implying that it's not really.
Right.
And so even in that, I understood there's a lot of hidden truths.
Right.
And so it made me wonder,
it very
so
well
therefore,
could be.
Where
I think,
is the
I think
real
your
tomb?
Critical point should stay home with the fact that it's occurred.
Yeah.
Well, not just the research,
okay,
but this event has occurred on this particular day.
Yes.
And where we're at in our walk with Yeshua, mm-hmm, as we go through these next 3 years, 3.5 years,
mm-hmm,
the criticalness of the event. Even if whether if it really is the tomb or not,
right,
the main thing is that there's an uprising and that they did that, and things are starting to like get more and more hostile.
Well, let me ask you this. Then, based upon your response just then, were they saying, did it literally say whatever you were reading? Did it say that the tomb of Joseph was in Israel?
Yes.
Okay.
Golan Heights.
All right.
Okay. So here, I want to move on because there's so many.
Yeah.
The United States is now accusing Israel of excessive force to defend against the terror that's occurring.
Will you make that statement again, please?
The United States is accusing Israel of excessive force.
Will you say that one more time? The United States of America
is accusing Israel of excessive force to defend against terror.
You would think they had never been to Israel and have the slightest clue of Israel is about the size of the DFW Metroplex and are surrounded by people who hate them and want to destroy them and blow them off the earth. How can you use excessive force? If they were crowded in around our families, if where we live in Dallas-Fort Worth area, or if we lived in, what was the state, New Jersey, that you always say?
Right.
If we lived in New Jersey and all the rest of the states in the world were gathered round about us saying, we're going to destroy you, we hate you, you're evil, and that you're sitting there with your little children and your home and your family and your God love and all of that, and they're saying, would you not like do everything in your power to defend yourself? I mean, that's like ludicrous. How can they say? And not only that, there's that iron dome above them, but they have constant, or I don't know that it's constant, but they have many rockets and bombs and terrorists and all
thousands.
One, you know, trying to destroy them on a daily basis.
Okay.
And yeah, it's just nuts.
Okay.
Right?
Well, here's the whole point of all of this is that the restrainer.
We stand with Israel.
Okay. The restrainer is being removed.
Uh-huh.
That's why these things are happening
the
way
they are. Has even been removed,
yes.
Perhaps. Yes.
Okay. All these things that are relative to darkness and unrighteousness is exactly what this is about. Okay, here's YouTube.
YouTube, all right.
Yeah, there is a movement for them to remove videos that incite terror.
I think that's great. Okay. Remove the videos that incite terror.
Well, you know, we were talking about this last night.
Yeah.
Or this morning, I can't remember.
One of our 4 o'clock conversations. Yes.
Where it's becoming really popular with the young people to videotape physical assaults to people that they don't even know.
Right.
That turn into a huge brawl and then put it on YouTube and get millions of hits. And that there's this huge desire and thirst for this kind of activity.
Right.
Okay. So the terror that they're talking about here removing is the jihadists calling people to come to do things that are against the believers
against Jews and Christians.
Yeah. Okay, so they're asking them to remove that. Okay, and but apparently it's being fed, and so as long as they're getting ads and advertisement and tons, they're going to get people to do these kind of things.
Well, I found it interesting on the site that I saw the article about that this morning, which was my United with Israel emails that I get, and it was where they were asking people to tell YouTube that you don't want this kind of stuff on there.
That's why I brought it up.
But yet they themselves had included a 60-second video of
the very
recap
thing.
Of terror, and I thought to myself, this is very bizarre.
Exactly.
And it kind of goes with our conversation in the night or the morning.
Give me a high five. That's exactly what I'm talking about.
What we think within ourselves, the things that we do, and it seems so justified and righteous, but yet when someone else is doing the same thing, we judge them by what we think their motive is, not by...
Hallelujah. You're exactly right.
Well, it's the Holy Spirit is doing a mighty work this
day. It is.
Thank you, Father. He is.
You, that's why I even started off with Noah. I mean, the righteous thinking of what somebody does or doesn't do, and how we think that what we're doing is righteous, and in God's eyes, is it righteous?
Yeah.
So the one that you need to be using your parameters of thinking is God's parameters,
exactly.
Not whether if you think it's right or not.
Right, exactly. The parameters set, the very first target is self. It's like God saying to me, it's time for you to crawl out of bed and spend more time inside your head.
Amen.
Take a deep think with the face in the mirror and let your glare hang there.
All right.
And that becomes the prophetic word to every human, every individual. May we spend more time inside our own head, analyzing our own motive, not other people, and by judging it by those standards of what God calls to be righteous. What we just read, what does God say is the right thing to do? It is to fear the Lord. So if you fear the Lord your God, then you're going to fear saying untrue things or drawing untrue by Jesus said, by what standards you judge, you will be judged. All right, so if we think we're judging righteously, we think we're judging in perfect truth, but there's only the problem is we're judging on based on what we see and we think we know, and when it seems so like cut and dry and this is the truth. But God alone, the Lord God Almighty alone is the one who knows the depth, the motivation, the heart, the many things that went. God is the one that he's the justifier. He can see how this could come to be and why you might truly believe that and be doing that. You're acting in faith of what you think, but in that, are you then utilizing not just what you do and the choices you're making, but are you then casting stones? Are you making judgments against other people?
Your analogy of looking at those listings of the United Israel, mm-hmm. and how one video,
which we enjoy that
site. Well, one video they said to watch was the actual one where the guy shot the guy with a hatchet. Okay, which in itself,
shoot with a hatchet, but I know what you
one
mean.
One guy was shooting the guy with the hatchet.
Yeah.
Okay, so
yes.
have that video, right. And that in itself promotes terror.
Yeah.
Okay, then right after it, it's another one where they have a movement saying that they're trying to get YouTube to pull that
violence
incites
videos.
Terror.
Right.
So it is weird.
Start it with self.
Exactly. That's how.
Don't
put those things on there. And exactly, it's what I'm talking about.
What's good for the goose is good for the gander.
Absolutely.
So to say. Yeah.
And that's how we escalate things. That's how mm-hmm. things get out of control. That's how things get confusion. And that is Hasatan's greatest weapon.
To make you think you're working for God when. And you're professing things with your mouth. Like God says, you love me with your mouth, but you're far away from me.
Okay.
Well, you told what was on the film. I was blessed by my phone wouldn't even open it. I tried to see what they
yeah.
were, but it didn't. It wouldn't even go there. It didn't happen.
Praise God. So. Okay. Now, what I'm about to tell you now is probably the saddest thing I could bring this morning.
Oh.
All right. But,
okay.
but there's a good side, and it just depends on how you look at this,
mm-hmm.
okay? They were following, when I say they, the authorities were following and putting surveillance on a Dr. Michael Roth.
Okay.
Last night, this Dr. Michael Roth, who is an OBGYN,
mm-hmm.
was stopped. And they opened up his trunk of his car and found 14 jars of baby remnants.
Oh my gosh.
He was doing illegal abortions.
They were remnants, then it was partial birth abortion.
What do you think this man was going to be doing with these things?
If he took the time to put them in jars, he had the intent to sell.
That happened in Michigan last night.
That is the saddest thing. Lord God, please forgive everyone for not knowing what they do. And for those who know what they do, may the Lord Himself rebuke that spirit within you and cause you to shudder with fear and remorse, to never be inclined and to cry out with a loud voice to spare the life of the most innocent.
In Yeshua's name.
Yeah, amen.
Okay, I saved that for next to last because
yeah.
I've got another one.
Yeah, that's kind of a downer.
It really
is. It's so important.
Okay. This morning in South Texas, around Laredo and Kingsville. That's kind of north of Brownsville.
Okay, so we've hit the home state.
Okay. There was a massive oil pipeline explosion.
Wow.
That has closed businesses and a school that was close by it. That happened this morning. I don't have any details on it.
So I guess there's a fire associated?
Huge, massive fire. They have pictures of it. It's a massive explosion. I don't know if they've been able to put it out, but usually whenever these oil things cut off,
mm-hmm.
they have these shutoff valves at different places. But the shutoff valves are, you know, in some cases could be even a mile or two apart.
Mm-hmm.
And all the oil that's in it has to burn up before it can.
Right.
So I don't know what that the extent of injuries or what, but right now that happened this morning in the AM, and don't know whether what it was caused by or what.
Sabotage or natural,
or what.
Whatever.
But that happened this morning,
wow.
Okay? in South Texas. So that pretty much covers
and
it.
And since
DJ,
that's down near the border, we know that there have been reports, pictures, and things that hit the internet for, I think, for several years now, of foreign military troops positioned
right.
just to the south of the Texas border, and also ISIS camps there. All kinds of stuff that kind of lost its place in the news
yep.
with so much that goes on everywhere.
Yep.
But the awareness of its existence has not been lost from those of us who call this our home. There's been several nuclear reactor plant or nuclear energy plants in the U.S. Have been, I don't know if you call it corrupted or infiltrated by people with a wrong agenda that somehow ended up with a role there, a job
yeah.
there. How would you ever give into the hands of someone who is, so to say, Muslim, a code key to enter into a nuclear site, knowing that, I guess Islam says of the United States that we are the beast that they
right.
determined to destroy. So they desire to destroy both the U.S.
and
Israel.
Right.
And so it's like this political correctness is just, you know, really losing it. No, my every fiber says to love all people. God gave us the love key. He demonstrated perfect love, knowing that there are good heart, if there are people that God will judge well in any manner of camps, and there are people God will judge fiercely in any manner of camps. And you know, it's on that one righteous one. And so we just pray that all come to the knowledge of the Lord our God through faith in his beloved anointed son, Yeshua of Nazareth, and that you be so transformed by the Holy Spirit of God that any hate-filled agenda you may have had be washed away and be made as white as lamb's wool, pure lamb's wool, with no hidden agenda any longer. And that would be for all of us. I pray
Amen.
That for all of us. Yeah.
Well, CJ, now I want to go back to where we're at in Yeshua's ministry walk.
And in Yeshua's name, this prayer we lift up.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
I want to go back to Yeshua's walk now because of this period that we're in.
Yeah,
and the things
here we
that
go.
Are occurring.
Back to his walk, yes.
One of the things that we talked about yesterday was Capernaum and then how it correlated to Mount Hermon.
Uh-huh.
Well, you see, the Golan Heights area, where this, where they said Joseph's tomb was,
mm-hmm.
well, see, that is also in that northern part of that area that we're talking mm-hmm. about.
Okay.
So I'm just letting everybody look at the events, where these locations and how mm-hmm. the hostilities are occurring and how, this area is being controlled by the UN
mm-hmm.
and how the Pope or the Vatican, how these things are going to start unveiling themselves over the next few days and next weeks because of the uptick of terrorism
mm-hmm.
that's occurring in this northern part of Israel.
Okay.
And that we have to realize that just like you and I are unveiling this truth within the two of us
right.
in regards to our words and the spirit behind our words
right.
and that the confusion and what Hasatan is attempting to try to do to keep us from being on the same righteous plane
yeah.
that's what's happening there in Jerusalem. At the same time, it's happening individually to you and I and then those that are listening, and that we have to really examine our oil, where we're at with the Father, and exactly what we were talking about. I mean, I don't want to recap
No, of course, and we shouldn't.
All this whole mourning of everything that we did, but to bring it to a close, and comments to you.
The thing, what I see God is doing is, no matter what the evil one determines to do, God has reset the tuning fork to 444. And I don't know if you noticed the other night as you and I were singing and worshiping, but having having gone from whatever it was called, 440 tuning to D sharp tuning, all of those things that we were filling around, playing with, that other, you know, that people do. But when we discovered that God, the music, worship music, the way God established it, is tuned to a 444, when we reset our instruments to 444, it made a huge difference. It was a bit awkward, because we've really learned culturally and worldly to operate slightly out of step with God. We've learned to sing a tune that's slightly off tune, and I don't mean like a voice tuned. We have learned to sing our heart song slightly distorted, as evil or worldly ways would want it to be. But when we literally tuned in tune the guitar, the stringed instrument, with God's own desire and will of his heart, putting it at a perfect 444, brings forward a 12 divine government. And we now being divinely governed by Yeshua, our Lord himself, being given over to his hand by the Father, Hashem. And our music the other night, our worship, was so much more pure, and it was revitalized.
Yeah.
And so I would be calling to all of you out there who are musicians, who play a stringed instrument, tune to a 444 and try your praise and your worship music there.
Can I expound on that a little bit?
I think you should if you have things that, yeah.
You know, CJ, for years, and I brought this up in one of our shows about a month or so ago. I can't remember. It's been a while, but it's worth bringing up, because this harmony that you're talking about,
harmony
with the frequencies that it creates of tuning your guitar to 444, is what the frequency is called, the love frequency.
Oh yeah, I forgot that detail. I'm so glad you added that.
And here's something else to understand. 440 was the standard that was created eons ago. Okay, all these frequencies, the 440 frequency.
There's nothing new under the sun.
Right. This is the tuning frequency. It's a frequency. The 440 frequency is demonic. It is the evil spirit. Then the 444 is the love spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So here, the love frequency. I'm sorry. So here's the deal. When the 440 was introduced to the American public, but it ended up going worldwide. But the 440 was used when Elvis Presley started, you know, swinging his hips and getting things down, that started the rock and roll era to move into the 440 tuning.
Slightly out of step with God.
Okay, so the reason why CJ is bringing this up about the 440 tuning,
444
tuning, is for that Paul McCartney.
McCartney.
It's McCarthy.
Well, you know, because
yeah.
McCarthy.
Yeah,
I mean, era.
Paul McCartney uses 440 tuning. Well, when I mentioned that to Norris.
Wait, slow down. You're going too fast. Paul McCartney, one of the Beatles. Which many girls would say was the cutest Beatle. Paul McCartney used the love, what did you call
tuning,
it?
Tuning, frequency.
Frequency. He used the love frequency of 444 tuning, and that's why we would understand that he was so warmly received,
right,
and had such a powerful influence in our day and our culture.
Yeah. So I mentioned that to Norris,
one of our good friends, Buck
Meyer, a good guitar player.
Oh, wow,
and
what a
And he goes, no wonder I haven't been able to play McCartney's songs, mm-hmm. because he didn't know that he had tuned to that level.
Right.
And when you tune to that level, all of a sudden his songs start to open up.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the reason why
that's awesome.
I the harmony aspect of our spirit, our frequency, our love frequency.
Being in harmony with God himself.
Yes. This is what he's fine-tuning us.
Yes.
And getting,
I like that.
Not only getting our music in line, but also getting our spirits and our Holy Spirits in line, so that when we do communicate, that it's not confused. It's not confusion. It is not the 440 tuning that creates this demonic area that is void of the love frequency.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Right.
So it's void of that light in the 440, and then the 444 is full of that light.
It's amazing what a difference a few degrees can make. And it's, you can see how being off kilter a few degrees, like 4 degrees, can make a huge difference in a building project.
Oh, my goodness.
If you start off and you replicate that offness, that 4 degrees, your building will be like the Tower of Pizza.
Pizza.
You know, here in Texas, we say the Tower of Pizza, but Pizza, okay. That you'll have something that is ready to tumble, that stands ready to fall, and what you want is a straight upright tower. You yourself want to be an upright tower, strong and steady, strongly and steadily placed on the firm foundation before God himself. And so the thing is, when people would hear, wait a minute, Elvis Presley, I love Elvis Presley, and I love Elvis Presley music. This is the message. The devil isn't like, or Satan doesn't get things done by everything being like Hitler. Because even Hitler's worst, it came at being off kilter a few degrees over a long period of time, where he got into the minds of the youth. And he built a culture of people who loved him and would and adored what he was doing to strengthen the nation and make it a place they would be proud to live. And what's happening in America is the same thing with Obama. He went straight to our schools and tried to endear our children to him and himself rather than to God himself. And it's that same mentality, give me the mind of a child at kindergarten and let me spend a few years with them and I can develop a nation that is a few degrees off and don't even recognize it. Because it really, didn't Elvis Presley's songs, Love Me Tender and all of that, don't those just like sound so good, it's what we want, but yet it's a few degrees off, it's a house ready to fall. And so the only way to get our house in order is to become in perfect alignment. Knock all the bricks down, knock the logs down, take everything back down, and start rebuilding the temple. Reset your tent. You are a member, you are a tent of witness, and let that be rebuilt and in a pure and upright manner. It makes me want to go get the guitar and start singing this
Amen.
Morning.
Amen. Well, CJ, I think this has been a great show.
It has been.
And I really appreciate the things of how God is getting into you and showing you this correlation of the walk, like what was happening at the Joseph's tomb, and how right now Yeshua is fine-tuning his believers, his body.
Yeah, in accordance with God's perfect will. Yes.
And it's so important to understand that that's what's going on right now. That the closer that we get, and I'm trying to stay ahead. God is leading me just enough
Absolutely.
To kind of keep things flowing here. And then these things that you bring in, like with the 444 tuning, that was far from me, but it was right on the tip. And that just confirms where we're at in Yeshua's walk, because this is when he's getting his disciples trained. This is when he's getting them ready before they actually send out the 70. Okay, we hadn't even got there yet.
Well, whether we're there or not, I don't rightly know in this moment, but I do know this. There are two things that I would want to say to that. First off, it's not one of my things, but I'm first off excited as you of the way things are going. God himself began to prepare me this morning before we ever came on. He began to show me what I was like in the classroom and how utilizing the newspapers daily. I was reading the newspapers, you know, like a hungry person to see, you know, what's going on that my students, we weren't just talking about random little fictional articles of those kind of things that they would muster up that you would talk about in the classroom, but that we were, it was real life. We were applying our learning opportunity together to take a look at the world around us and what might we do to make it a better place. Not just what did we think someone else should do, but what were we ourselves willing to do? First, you have to see what's going on, weigh it against the spirit. And the thing is, when I want to, this is one of the things I would like to clarify, just to put it into to terms that everybody would understand. There is only one Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit of God. One Holy Spirit. All of us earth beings, we have a spirit within ourselves. We have a spirit. It's your personality. It was what, it's how people know you. They know you by the spirit. You know, they remember you by your spirit. If it's good or bad, you know, pleasant or vile, you know, how, whatever is your spirit. But when God takes the spirit of two or three or whatever, earthly spirit, we are earthly beings. We have a spirit. We have a personality, a style. And when God chooses to send his Holy Spirit, who comes and stands in between or filters over with, from the inside out and overrides, God doesn't destroy our spirit within. He brings it to a fullness. It doesn't get to stay what it was, but he uses our own, each spirit. He finds those that he determines and desires to build a harmony between in his holiness by pouring in his Holy Spirit to be born again, to then see it's a new level. It's rise. It's coming out of what our natural spirit maybe is tuned to a 440. But when God's Holy Spirit comes into us, then all of a sudden we have been retuned to a 444, which is the love key. Like God shown on the scroll, there is both the draconian key and the love key. So the draconian key doesn't even necessarily have to be presented in the beginning as a vile, ugly thing. It could be Elvis Presley or any kind of music, you know, things that we might hold dear to ourselves. And we can't even see how it caused us to be offset a bit until God hands us that love key, that 444, and retunes us in perfect harmony with himself. Do we have the capacity as earth beings to go back and forth like a reed blowing in the wind? Unfortunately, we do. And this is where the scripture warns us not to, I can't remember the word specific, but don't deny the Holy Spirit. Don't quench, I guess is the word I was looking for. Don't quench. So whoever was praying that in, thank you. Don't quench the Holy Spirit. It means don't drive the Holy Spirit away by keeping on trying to take things into that 440 tuning. Allow the Holy Spirit to be the monitor or the determining factor that, because when we strike that, it's like tuning the guitar. One thing may be a little bit to the flat side. One might be a little bit to the pitchy side. But when the Holy Spirit enters the scene, we become in perfect harmony. We've got that straight up tuning on the key. You know you're in perfect sync. And we've seen it demonstrated here this day, like you pointed out so many times. It feels so right, and it felt so right in our music the other night. And to really open the door to flow with the Spirit of the Lord. I mean, I kept saying this, that God is here with us. The Spirit of the Lord is upon us. It was like so holy and wonderful. And it's one of those moments you wish you could capture and put it in a bottle and never lose it. And the good news is God does. God has that recorded for history. Maybe one day He'll let us watch the game film. And there are those, many of those films I don't ever want to see. You know, please God, burn them, throw them into the sea of forgetfulness and never to be brought up again. And I'm just so blessed for the 444 love key that God alone can deliver.
Amen.
Here was the second thing. God was showing me that in the classroom I used these current events, and that what He wants to happen, what happened this morning is what He wants to happen. You are now the one following the news, just as I did then. You are following the news. You are bringing forward these things. And I get the opportunity, just like in the songs that He gave and the lessons that He was teaching in those days through me, when His Holy Spirit came in, there was another. All the songs that were written, whether they were the very politically based 1998 that even incorporated Bin Laden, and you and the guys were saying, how do you know about Bin Laden? And I'm like, well, I read the newspaper every day with my students in the classroom. This is something we've been talking about for months. And it's just it's in the news all the time. And Saddam Hussein and all those, you know, characters that were part of the time. Well, so God needed those things to be known. He needs the current events to be brought to the forefront.
Amen.
We don't stop with man's interpretation of it. Now God has something to say about it.
Yes, and it's in line with His.
That's Holy Spirit alone can do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. He takes your spirit and your interests, and He uses you to go and bring out these topics. The same as He has done with me so many times, and He's now given you that role. He took that part from me, and He gave that part to you. And for me, then He lets, however, you know, to bring in the spiritual element. It's sort of like Russ Houck's pyramid, mm-hmm. where he presents it upside down, and my spirit was wrestling with that. And I thought, wow, that's really kind of awkward for me, because God Himself showed me the pyramid upright. And then when I spoke it to Him, He goes, yes, that's the Holy Spirit. That's, you know, that's where the Holy Spirit is. And this is the part that we're showing is the earth walk. And I'm like, and it made perfect sense. The two form a diamond. It has a spinning diamond.
Right.
And so it's obvious God has given, he makes perfect music by putting both what is happening. Somebody has to talk to us about what's happening. And it makes more sense than it should be the history buff who enjoys history. And not only do you see the level of what is today, but you're able to tie it in historically and even to Bible scripture.
Amen.
And then He's taught me to know scripture well enough that I can engage in the conversation. God is so holy, amazing.
And this is the enjoyable walk that we have, that CJ and I have, and that we're hoping that those that are listening
Get excited too and start seeking.
And see how these examples can be used in your own life.
Yes, and not stop here. Just see, okay, wow, these people are on fire. They're seeing things and not being in fire in a bad way. Passionate about what's going on, and that you too get passionate about what's going on. So what does God call us to do first? To love one another. When I asked Father one day, Father, what would you, dear Abba, Father, God in heaven, you know, just Father was all I said, Father, what would you have me to do? And He said instantly, walk in my statutes, keep my commands, and love one another.
Amen.
And so with that, it's in that category of Walking in obedience with the Lord your God, fearing him to the point that you trust him above everyone and everything, and to love him and to serve him. How do you serve a God if you don't know what his will is? It's not just what you think it is. God said you must know the Bible. So please, please, please open your Bible this day and read it. And you know what I did yesterday, Randy? I finally took those Bible readings, and this is my plan for each day. You re-air the show, and I took the Bible, and I am going to present different books in between. Each show will be one book of the Bible, and you know, there'll be the show of the day, a couple of songs, and then one book out of the Bible. In between each recording, there'll be a song, and it ties them together. And then here comes our daily show again, Yahweh Love Life. Isn't that a cool plan? Yeah. God put that in.
Yeah, and I'd like to talk to you about that off air. All right, everybody. thank y'all for listening today. May the blood of our Lord Yeshua be upon each one of you. Have a wonderful Shabbat. Rest in him. And he deserves all of your praise and glory and all of our praise and glory. Because we are and have been blessed, and he is in the process of purifying and sanctifying us, and to the point to where harmony is
absolutely
our victory.
Absolutely. Harmony is our victory. And then with that said, we want you to know we're not here to wrestle out with anyone what day is this you choose to keep, Sabbath wise. That's between you and your Father in heaven. It's just like Romans 14 tells us not to wrestle out such matters, but to have love between ourselves. My question to myself was, in that Jesus himself, Yeshua, says to pray that the time that you need to flee not be in the winter or on the Sabbath. If the Sabbath would be any day, and if for whatever reason God's holy day that he rested, that the one day that God literally blessed that day, God blessed the Sabbath, so then those who would keep the Sabbath will be blessed for doing so, or partake of a blessed day, let's say that. So you have to ask yourself the question at some point, if we're told to pray you don't have to flee on the Sabbath, how could that be every single day? I don't know. It's just something that God caused me
amen.
To wrestle out. Yeah.
Amen.
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 And aho. Woo-hoo. Happy Friday. Shabbat Shalom.